on today's Fixit Friday, broken range and direction shifter arms on an International 574 tractor. Check it out. Okay, so the problem today is that the tractor won't move anymore under its own power. Engine runs fine, everything else works fine, but what has happened is the high-low range shifter arm as well as the directional shifter arm snapped off right at the case. You can see it right there. I actually don't recall which is which, but nevertheless, both broke off. Now the high-low range one probably broke off a few years ago. I had lost the high or low range, I don't know, probably 3 or 4 years ago, and never really worried about it because for the most part, most of the work that the tractor does around here is snow blowing, so I never really needed high range, so I never worried about it. Never investigated, didn't know that it actually had broken off. But, come this weekend, this last weekend, and tractor was snow blown, nearly done, go to shift into forward, wouldn't go. Finally, I had to go and have my neighbor push me into the shop with his tractor and so that I could have a look at it. So the first thing I got to do is I got to take all the tins off of the transmission here, or off over top of the transmission. It'll be like the seat, fuel tank, any of these tins have to come off. And then the whole top of the transmission can come off. There's a cover there. I did a little bit of investigation and there was an international mechanic who stated that you can actually do that, and he said, once you get all the tins off and you get the top off, it's a 5-minute job to replace the shifter arms, or the shifter arm. I think it was a range that he was talking about in that case, but I'm assuming that the directional one will be just as easy. So in any case, let's pull the tins off and we'll have a look at the tractor here. Okay guys, so all the tins are off. You can see there's a big pile of parts right there. There's a pile of parts right here. Fuel tank is obviously drained. Something interesting came out of that. I've had fuel problems for the last few years. Here's the crossover line between the sides of the saddle tank, and you can see some black goop had actually plugged this line, and it's actually some kind of almost like goop. I don't know if somebody used like a tank sealer on it and it cracked it up, or if that's just 40 years that stuff turned to goop. But anyways, that was interesting. So there's the other viewpoint of the range box of the transmission for the tractor. So what my plan is here is that I got to take this whole top piece off. I think I said that already, but I'll say it again. And what I have to do first before I can even do that is I have to disconnect all of these hydraulic lines. There's some fuel lines here, another fuel line there. That might be, actually that's the return. So I got to pull those off, then that line off, and then I got to take these arms off. I probably don't have to take those arms off, I can disconnect them up here, but I think it'll make it a little bit lighter because I think this is going to be a pretty heavy piece. And then I can take the whole top of this piece off and I can access the location where these two shift levers are, which is here and here. This front one is the high-low range shift arm, and the rear one is where the forward and reverse shift arm goes. I am told that I could have possibly accessed these shift arms without this whole big faff of taking the top off by taking off this unit right here, which is the MCV, which is, I believe, multiple control valve is what that stands for. It's also the hydraulic filter. But I actually talked to the case mechanic who had done this before. You'd actually had to replace some of the shift arms on some of these tractors, and he thought about it and he said, well, you could do it, but he figures there's a PTO shaft coming through here that you'd have to work around. He said you'd be working blind, and if you dropped anything into the case, you're screwed basically. And he said that even knowing that he could go in that way and being an experienced mechanic, he said he would still do it the long way, which would be by taking off this whole top piece. Because because he said that it's just, it's not going to be any hassle at all once you do that. You know, it's a hassle to get that far, but it's no hassle to once you do pull everything apart here. So anyway, so I take these lines off and see if I can't get this top off of here. So one thing I'll show you is I bought a used high-low range shift arm off of a person on eBay. That took a bit of time for it to come. It's actually been a few weeks since the first segment of the video there. They actually sent me the wrong part and I had to send it back. So I only just got this on Friday. And quite frankly, I probably should have just tried to buy it from Case, because I went to Case and I got a whole bunch of other parts all new. Here is the forward and reverse shift arm for the tractor, and I got that new. It was moderately expensive. It was like about $150 for that. Granted, this all told ended up probably costing about the same, you know, once you factor in shipping and exchange rate, because that's 150 Canadian. But I actually was amazed that this they were actually had these parts available new, so that was really handy. You know, the used parts might be preferable, but this looks every bit as good as the used part. What would happen to these things is that they would break, they'd shear right at the O-ring groove, and you can actually see why. If I just look at this here, you can see that when they cut the O-ring groove, they cut it sharp. It wasn't like it was a radius curve. They cut it sharp, and that obviously makes a stress point, and that's where both arms broke off on my tractor. In any case, I just thought you guys would like to see those parts. You can, like I said, it's amazing enough, you know, 40-some-year-old tractor, you can still get new parts for it. Now, I'll just show you the part number for this arm if anybody ever needed it. In any case, let's go on and see if we can't take that top off of that unit. Okay, so I got all the hydraulic lines off that need to come off. Damaged one brake line, which is unfortunate, but fortunately that is the easiest thing for me to fix. Some lines I couldn't take off, so I just pulled them out of the way, disconnected some that didn't need to completely come off, and set up something, a lifting arm, and I'll set it up to lift over here, and we'll see how we go here. This whole assembly, this part especially, is part of the casting. This part could come off, but I figure, you know, it's going to be the least of my problems. Debating whether or not I should maybe take the actual arms themselves off. Actually, I think I will. I'll just get them out of the way. Won't be snagging on anything. And then it's going to be the fun of lifting this thing up. So I've got all the bolts broken loose. I'm just doing some final cleanup so I could avoid getting as much crap as possible into the internals of the range box. But I don't know how successful I'm going to be, so it's just going to have to deal with it. I did buy two hydraulic filters, so I'll put one in, run it for probably a few hours of running time, you know, like one snow blowing probably, and I'll replace it and hopefully that'll pick up any crap that gets into the range box. No guarantees. Oh well, this has been quite a nightmare. There have been so many hydraulic lines across here and they all trap each other, and yeah, it's just been a circus. Anyways, I'm going to finish cleaning this up and then we'll pop the top. Okay, so the top's off the range box. No grief over the lifting arrangement. That's just the way I did it. So, what we've got here is our range box. It does forward, reverse, high and low speed. And there's the various parts in here. This is the parking brake. It never worked for me, but I actuated it and it seemed to grab, so I don't know why it doesn't work, but nevertheless. Locker, to lock the rear axles together. Differential, obviously, back there you can see the gear for the PTO. Down in here is some of the fun stuff here. So this is the fork for forward and reverse. And I don't know if I can actuate it or not. It's pretty, there we go. So that should be probably forward, I'd say. And if I could push it back, it would be in reverse. It's too hard to. These things are quite tight, actually. There's quite the detent in them as well. And this is the high-low shift arm. Right now that should be in low because I don't think you can actually put it in high and reverse at the same time, although this is forward. But nevertheless, So that's it there. So here's our culprit. This is the arm that attaches to the arm assembly for the forward reverse shift arm, and this is the arm that attaches to the high-low assembly to actuate the fork there. Now, this is fairly easy to get to, you know, here. Just get my good old, I'm not sure what that is, looks like 3/4, might be a little bit bigger on there, and I can pop those off in seconds. It looks like I could have come in through the MCV. It, you know, it's hard to tell. Here, I'll go around to the other side and I'll show you. Okay, here we are from the other side. You can see the two shift forks. And you can, if you look down there, you can see the hydraulic pump. And I believe that's attached directly to the MCV. So it looks like I could have come in there, you know, up and around that red part of the casting there and get to that nut. So I could have saved myself a little bit of trouble in pulling this apart here, but I'm fine with it going the way it has right now. So what am I going to do now? Well, now I'm going to undo that bolt and the corresponding one on that arm and swap those out, and I'll show you them actuating the forks before I button this thing back up. Okay, so here's the old shaft out, and there's the new shaft right there. As far as I can tell, they're absolutely identical. She thinks they're absolutely identical. Tried the nut on there, tried the arm on there, and it fit fine. You'll notice there's a slight difference in the threads between the two there. Somebody's getting in my light, so sorry about that, guys, but it looks like it's going to be a perfect fit. Everything is exactly the same, including the O-ring groove, which is square cut and probably will break again right there. So in any case, if it does, hey, I've got a model and I'll actually try and machine one next time. But regardless, let's get this in and button that thing up. Okay, so you can see the high-low range arm is out. You know, the broken part is anyways. And compared it to the used part I bought, and it looks identical apart from the used part is yellow, but it's in there all good and tight. Everything is working correctly as far as I can tell. I thought you guys might find this interesting, just how the transmission works here. So basically, this gear at the front is the output of the speed transmission there. I'm going to call it that. I'm not 100% sure it's the case, but this is your 1, 2, 3 gear shift, and all that gearing is in there. Now, range box has high-low range, as well as forward and reverse. And forward and reverse is controlled by this arm and this gear here. And high-low is controlled by this arm, which is controlled by engaging a collar that, you know, directly couples the output shaft of the range box, or I guess it's really going straight into the differential there, and to the transmission. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to just show you some of how it works here. So we'll shift into reverse, and you'll see that the input shaft is going in. As I push down, it wants to go up, or as I pull up, it's going down on that end. So you can actually see it's going in opposite directions to this here. And that's because of how it's geared up here. So we've got this small gear driving a larger gear here. So we'll throw a little bit of light down there. And that larger gear drives a smaller gear right down there underneath this large main gear, which in turn drives this little jack shaft here, which this gear will engage in reverse. And what you'd see is that this would be turning probably counterclock or clockwise normally, the main output shaft. That'd mean this one was turning, that gear right down there, the big gear, would be turning counterclockwise, which would drive this one clockwise. This would go clockwise to drive this output counterclockwise. Now, if we go and we switch to forward, so we'll go click, click, and what we do is Now we skip that little jack shaft there, so it's, we're not getting a reverse anymore. We're still getting clockwise rotation driving this, and bear with me, that might be, I might be backwards, but it's the differences that's important. Okay, so now we're in forward. The output of the transmission is giving us, speed transmission, is giving us a clockwise rotation, I'm assuming. That would mean that this shaft would be driven, being driven, or that gear would be driven counterclockwise, which drives a gear under there in the same direction, counterclockwise, which would drive this gear in the same direction as the engine, which is going to be clockwise. Yeah, as I said before, that's assuming that that's the direction of the rotation that the engine makes, but as you can see, both are tied together, although not at the same ratio. Now, if we shift this into neutral, now nothing is engaged here. We'll take our magnets everywhere. We take our speed transmission, or high-low range, I should say. It engages this collar directly with the gear, tying the output shaft directly to the engine. So whatever direction the engine is rotating in, we're going to say clockwise in this case, the output shaft will rotate in the same direction at the same ratio. And you say to yourself, cool! You know, we're going high speed because we're probably not getting a gear reduction. I can't tell what the gear reduction is, but the large gear down there looks significantly bigger. So I'm going to guess it's probably on the order of, I don't know, 3-to-1 or something like that. It might be 2-to-1, something like that. But when it's directly engaged, obviously it's 1-to-1. Now, I'll show you something bad that can happen if your linkage gets crossed. So we're in high, and we can get shifted into reverse, let's say. So now you're in both reverse and high. That won't work, because what's happening now is the output of the engine is directly tied to the output shaft of the transmission, which is a bit of a misnomer because they really, it's just going straight into the differential that you can see right there. So in any case, so that's tied to the engine. That's tied the output shaft directly to the engine. But now we've got this gear driving that large gear down there, which drives our little jack shaft, which drives, you know, this large gear. And both of them are locked together and nothing wants to turn. It's basically like you've frozen up your transmission. And I can say from experience, it's a tough one, because what ends up happening is the second you let out the clutch, the engine basically stalls because the transmission can't move. So that's a bad situation. The same thing can happen with if this goes into forward, but I think that's a little bit more rare. I think that's happened to me more times when I've been putting something into reverse. So anyways, I thought that you guys might find that kind of interesting, just about how this transmission works. Since I got it all cracked open, we might as well look at it. Anyways, we move on to the next thing here. Okay, so one bit of frustrating news is I got everything all put together, like I already said. I did drop this nut into the sump of the range box here. I did fish it out with my magnet, but you don't want to know what I found. I found this in the sump, and it clearly has went through some gears at some point. I can't tell what it was. It might have been a washer. Might have been just a piece of debris that was in there. I don't know. It clearly went through some gears. You can see the gear tooth shape on it there. So not sure where that came from. The other thing I found was I also found this, it's not a snap ring, it's a C-ring. And I'm not sure where that came from, because there's nothing in this transmission that uses C-rings that I can see, or this range box that uses C-rings. The only thing I could think of was down there, if you see that small gear at the very, very bottom, that does have a snap ring on it. And the only thing I can think of is that at some point in the life of this transmission, or tractor, that popped off and sucked it through the gears of the transmission. So I don't know what to say about that. I can't see any place else that that C-ring could have come off of. Nothing else is retained by a C-ring. The parking brake has pins with cotter pins on it, so it didn't come out of there. There's this, you know, clutch system down here, but I don't think I can see anything on it that could have possibly caused that problem. So I'm kind of a little flummoxed here by that. So I don't know what to say. I think that's an overrunning clutch because that's on the side is the... I'm not going to say. I'm just going to say it's some sort of a clutch assembly that I'm presuming is used to drive the side PTO that goes out there, which I don't have on this tractor. In any case, I'm going to button it up with, you know, some trepidation. I'm going to fish around a little bit more and see if I find anything else in there. But if I can't, I'm not going to worry about it because I don't know what it came from. You know, it doesn't seem like it could have come from anywhere. It doesn't look like it could have, you know, made its way over, you know, there's a partition between the rear and the front. So I don't think it could have come out of there. So I'm kind of at a loss for where that came from. In any case, I'm going to choose not to worry about it. And I'm going to button this thing back up and get it sealed back up. But I will look through the parts manual and see if I can figure out anything there. Anyways, guys, I'll put the top back on and we'll go from there. Okay, so you know how I said that I couldn't think of any place that C-ring could have come from? Well, it occurred to me that this isn't the only place it could have come from. It could have come from the lid where the hydraulic cylinder is for the lift arms for the three-point hitch. And here's something interesting. I think somebody has been in here before because I don't think that this came from the factory with what looks like clear silicone sealant sealing the gasket in place. And I also don't think that the factory would have trapped a C-ring right there in the transmission or right in the hydraulic cylinder assembly. There's copious things that it could have come from under here. I didn't see anything. I think that somebody was into this thing at some point and drop some parts into it. So, because I can't see any fittings or any C-rings that are missing anywhere. So, and I had a very, very thorough look. I'm satisfied that it's okay. So now that I have an idea where it came from and have, you know, some measure of evidence that somebody else was messing around in here, you know, like I at least can have somebody I can blame that on. Regardless, I don't think there's anything more that's going to fall into there. I am going to try and get that out of there, and then I'm going to clean the gasket surfaces, and I'm going to button this thing back up and call it a night. It's starting to get late. Anyways, guys, get this thing sealed up. Okay, there you go. Top's back on. That was a bit of a pain in the ass, but it's there. It's on. See a little bit of the... What, Permatex squeezing out a bit there. I probably used a little bit too much. Hopefully there's not going to be too much in the range box. When it's done, I'll see how it goes. All I care about is that these are on there, and we'll go from there. Anyways, guys, so the next shot of this is going to be, well, with me putting hydraulic lines back on. Okay, so I've finished connecting up almost all of the hydraulic lines. There's one more that goes between here and there. But that can't go in until the seat assembly is in. It's a little short little link to between those two points. Replace the hydraulic brake line, reconnect all the other lines. I still have to put the fuel lines in. This is the return, and right there is the supply. There's the lines for one of them. I think that's probably for the supply. And the return is probably sitting around here somewhere. I'm going to take them off and clean them up. And then put them on. I'm going to blow them out because I don't know what kind of corruption has been in those things there. Then hopefully we can finish assembling this thing here. Okay, now since the transmission, or those two shift arms down there, are the reason why I had to enter into this whole enterprise here, I figured I'd show you guys how it works. Now this right here is a separate arm that is the speed for the speed transmission. That right now is in first, second, third, and that's fourth. So what I'm doing when I move that is I'm moving this arm down here through the range. That's in fourth right down there. So that's how that part works. It's not really that important. I didn't open this one up, so you guys didn't get to see the linkage or any of that stuff in there. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to show you how this works, how we can keep, or how this is supposed to, because I've gotten it into high end and some of the other gears at one point or another, but how it's supposed to keep you from shifting this lever into high and these levers into either forward or reverse, or this lever into forward or reverse. And what they've got is they've got a gate here, and by moving this lever back and forth, you control, well, it wasn't exactly in position, but you control where that little arm goes and which one of these two arms it engages. So when you pull it to the left, you know, from the driver's point of view, this comes up and engages this this top arm that engages the reverse and forward shift arm. Now for when you want to go into high, you flip it that way, and high only has forward. You can't go backwards for reverse, and actually this sheet metal actually has a block in there as well as this to prevent you from trying to pull it into reverse when you're holding it into high. So we pull it into high, bring it down, and that engages that there. Now we saw earlier exactly, you know, like what that was engaging inside, so I'm not too worried about explaining that, but that, you know, now I can't move this shift arm to try and engage the other pawl partially. So the only thing I can do is shift it back into neutral, which, you know, you can see here, I can engage either pawl alternately, you know, and if I want to shift the low range into forward, well, that's easy enough. There's forward. That's reverse. That was neutral. This is reverse. We go back into neutral, and now we can engage this again. So in any of these other ones, you can't, you know, other than the slop and the actual linkages, you can't disengage that arm when it's either in forward here or reverse. You can move it a bit, which is kind of sloppy as far as I'm concerned, but you can move it, but you can't actually engage it. Now, how I've managed to get this into two gears at once is a good question. I think probably what happened was I was in neutral and I probably pulled, got one, and then managed to probably pop it out again on the other one, but I couldn't tell you how that exactly happened. It's happened to me a few times, but hey, you know, it's a sloppy old linkage. Somebody's replaced some of the pins with bolts that don't exactly hold very well. There's a spring here that's supposed to hold it in the low position, you know, kind of sloppy, nothing much you can do, but I did put new bushings into the arm, so the arm itself is a lot more solid, but you know, it occurred to me afterwards that there's so much slop in this setup here, you know, like that you're not going to get any more positive feeling of a shift in this thing, so such as it is. Okay, so now that I've explained that, the next thing I'm going to do is I want to start putting the sheet metal on, but before I can do that, I'm going to clean up the fuel lines, I'm going to blow them out, I'm going to take the filters off, take this line here, which it goes to the fuel filters, blow it out backwards, and once I'm satisfied the lines are cleaned out, then I'm going to put the fuel tank back on and reconnect these things up. There's a little bit more cleanup I have to do with this stuff. You know, like there's the petcocks for the fuel, and they're all choked with that black crap, whatever that was. And there's the crossover line over here I got hanging up. You can see some of that black goop dripping out of it. I have no idea what it is. I'm assuming it's some kind of a sealer. I'll blow it out and we'll see what it looks like, but I think it all looks like tar. In any case, a few other things to hook back up here, and then we're almost ready to go with this thing. So I blew out that crossover line, and this is what came out. There wasn't a lot of it that came out, but some of it came out, and it was definitely plugging it. But it's weird. It kind of smells sweet. I don't know what to make of it. Like, the only thing that occurred to me is it some sort of just sealer that just happens to smell sweet? Or did somebody dump some molasses in the tank, you know, out of revenge or something like that? I don't know. Might have explained why I had some problems a while ago, but who the hell knows? No telling. In any case, I think I'm going to just replace that line. It's not exactly a hard line to make, and I've certainly got some, I don't know what that is, 5/16, 3/8 line? I think it looks 3/8 to me. It's a simple line to make, so I'll just remake it. I've got flare fittings as well, so not a big deal. So on we go. Okay, so where am I standing with this thing here? Well, pretty much my pile of parts has dwindled. You know, everything here is all back together. Still have to reconnect those, but I'm waiting, and I still have to put the attachment for the adjustment bar back on the back. But I'm waiting until I get a new one of these. Well, I actually got the fittings and realized that I don't have any steel line. Not 1 foot of 5/16 steel line. So 7:30 on a Saturday night, not many places are going to be open, or at least would be open when I get there. So I am going to leave this till tomorrow, but I'll leave you with this, that it is almost all together. You know, apart from those few big things on the back, apart from I have to replace this, which is bad, but that shouldn't be a big deal. And I need one carriage bolt for here, 1/3 carriage bolt. That must be, I don't know, what, about an inch long, looking at that one. And then we'll be good to go. And then I have to top up with all the fluid. Have a look at this. This is over $200 worth of hydraulic fluid right here. How do you like that? $200, was it 18, 19 liters per pail, or about 5 US gallons per pail? So anyways, oof, that was an expensive evening. And you're supposed to replace that every year, or every, I think it's, I can't remember how many hours, it doesn't really matter. Anyways, guys, nearly ready to go. Next shot will be this thing running and ripping around and blowing some snow, because wow, this has been a mega effort here. Okay, so the whole thing is together. I'm just charging the battery. I still have to put some diesel in it and top up the well, I actually fill the hydraulic fluid and transmission fluid. But this was never something I would have figured was going to be that big a pain in the ass. That filter, oil or fuel filter, was locked on and I almost couldn't get it off. But that I found very interesting. There's some more of that black gook in here. So I don't know what, where that came from, but it locked this filter on like glue, and it made it through the to the first filter. Anyways, I call this primary. So I made it to the primary, but the good news is that there's no sign of that black gook in the secondary. So it's a good thing I replaced these filters. I guess I'm gonna have to take this tank off again this summer and get somebody to go and clean it, because yeah, I don't know what that black gook is, but somebody must have spiked my gas, I think is what happened. It's what it's really looking like right now. So I don't know what they put in there, if they put molasses in there or what the fuck that shit is, but anyways, let's get this thing started. There you go. Problem solved. Right, Kat? Right.